Good afternoon, and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Deborah England, Senior Program Officer at the Corrett Foundation and your chair for the program. Tonight's program is generously underwritten by the Corrett Foundation as part of the Principles of a Free Society series. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, David Walker, former U.S. Comptroller General and author of the new book, Come Back America, Turning the Country Around and Restoring Fiscal Responsibility. Mr. Walker is one of the U.S.'s foremost independent financial experts. He was Comptroller General of the United States and head of the U.S. Government Accountability Office from 1998 to 2008. Notably, although Mr. Walker was appointed Comptroller General by President Bill Clinton, his career as the federal government's chief auditor spanned both Democratic and Republican administrations. While at the GAO, Mr. Walker embarked on a fiscal wake-up tour, partnering with the Brookings Institute, the Concord Coalition, and the Heritage Foundation to alert Americans to wasteful government spending. In 2008, Walker was personally recruited by Peter G. Peterson, co-founder of the Blackstone Group and former Secretary of Commerce, to lead his new foundation. Mr. Walker is now president and CEO of the Peter G. Peterson Foundation and a sought-after speaker and writer who has appeared on many TV networks, cable channels, and radio programs, as well as testified before Congress and written for several major publications. He has won numerous leadership and public service awards and authored two books on restoring fiscal responsibility in this country. An outspoken critic of excessive government spending, Mr. Walker has argued that the U.S. is analogous to the Roman Empire in its decline due to our national debt, our rising Medicare costs, and the expense of prospective universal health care, immigration, and our military commitments abroad. He warns that the credit crunch could portend a far greater fiscal crisis and that the United States is, quote, underwater to the tune of $50 trillion. On that sobering note, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Mr. David Walker.
Thank you, Deborah. Thank you to the Commonwealth Club, thank you for that kind introduction. And Don, thank you for serving as moderator. Thank all of you for coming this evening. Let me just say that you'll probably feel like having a drink after you hear all of this. But the good news is there is hope, and there is a way forward, and that's what the book is all about. The book is not just about talking about the problem. The book lays out a number of proposed solutions dealing with policy, operational, and political reforms. And let me provide you kind of some highlights and save plenty of time for questions and answers. In my view, America is a great nation, arguably the greatest in the history of all mankind. But we're not as great as we think we are. If you look at where we stand on a number of key critical indicators, public finance, education results, health care, critical infrastructure, and a variety of other key factors, we are below average for an industrialized nation. There are too many people in this country that rely upon our past success and that rely upon our current sole superpower status, which is temporary, and they take too much comfort in that fact, and they assume that we must be number one, or at least top three, a medalist, in just about everything, when the truth is, we're not. Again, what's important is that we state the facts, speak the truth, recognize reality, and take steps to make sure that we don't repeat some of the mistakes that others have made in the past. It's not just a matter of what we do, it's a matter of what we fail to do. Because as a fiduciary, one can engage in fiduciary breaches because you do something that you shouldn't do, but you also can engage in breaches because you don't do things that you should do. And to a great extent, that's where a lot of our challenges are today. In the book, entitled Come Back America, it's based upon my experience as Comptroller General of the United States and going to 46 states around this country in the last 4 years, conducting town hall meetings, speaking with business community leaders, editorial boards, local media, etc. I think I have a pretty good sense on where the American people are. And it allows me to do things that I couldn't do as Comptroller General. I can make specific recommendations with regard to policy reforms, with regard to political reforms and other things that there's no way I could have done as Comptroller General, things that need to be done. Because while the American people have woken up, they know we have a problem. They want to know what do we need to do and what can I do to fix the problem. And before I go too much further, I want to acknowledge that the Northern California Fiscal Advisory Council group is here, who are fighting for fiscal responsibility and trying to help save our future. And you may want to raise your hands just to know that you're here. So if you want to talk to them later after the session, I'd encourage you to do that, because they're very active here in Northern California. But the topic, the name of the book has a dual meaning. We need to come back to the principles and values under which this country was founded, that made us great, that we've strayed from in recent years. And secondly, we need to recognize reality, that we face a number of serious sustainability challenges that threaten our collective future. We need to make tough choices sooner rather than later so that we can have a comeback and our future can be better than our past. And let me give you a few examples. With regard to basic principles and values, this country was founded on the principle of opportunity, not entitlement. It was founded on the principle of thrift and value, not just throwing money at problems. It believed in savings rather than debt. It believed in personal responsibility rather than collective irresponsibility. And it believed very much in our stewardship responsibility to future generations. And what do I mean by that? Stewardship means that your responsibility as a leader is not just to generate positive results today. It's not just to leave things better off when you leave than when you came. It's to leave things better positioned for the future. And my generation, the baby boom generation, is the first generation in the history of this great country that is not discharging its fiduciary and stewardship responsibility. This country is not better positioned for the future financially and fiscally, environmentally, in other ways. And that needs to change because it is a part of what America is all about. In fact, I would argue that the American dream is at risk and the Republic is at risk over time if we don't wake up and start making some tough choices. And what do I mean by the American dream? To me, that's not owning a house, although most of us probably do, and I'm fortunate enough to. It's really two dimensions. The first dimension is it's the ability of every individual American to achieve their full potential based upon their own efforts and their God-given abilities. And secondly, it's the responsibility of each generation to leave things better off and better positioned for the future. Again, that concept of stewardship. If you look at where we are, and if you look at where we're headed, we clearly face a number of key challenges that will require tough transformational changes, policy, operational, and political. And the book addresses all three, and specific proposed solutions on all three. They're based on my personal views, which may or may not be the same as the Peterson Foundation. And let me mention a few. Let me start with our financial and fiscal condition. This country is in much worse shape financially than politicians will tell you. It has been engaging in a range of creative accounting and self-dealing practices for many years, especially with regard to the so-called trust funds, and I put that in quotes because they really trust the government funds. Or as Pete Peterson would say, you can't trust them, they're not funded. The simple fact is that Washington uses a number of words that don't mean the same thing as Webster's Dictionary, and trust funds are one. We need to recognize the reality that the four factors that contributed to the mortgage-related subprime crisis exist for the federal government's own finances. And what are they? Number one, a disconnect between those who benefited from prevailing policies and practices and those who paid the price and bore the risk when the bubble burst. In the case of the federal government's finances, today's taxpayers benefit from low-tax, high-spend policies, and tomorrow's taxpayers will pay the price and bear the burden. More on that in a few minutes. Secondly, a lack of adequate transparency as the nature and extent and magnitude of the related risk. In the mortgage-related subprime, we had all types of securitized arrangements, credit default swaps, so-called insurance arrangements, et cetera, derivatives, that weren't well known, weren't well understood, in many cases were off the balance sheet, you didn't see it. And as a result, there were a lot of big and bad surprises when the bubble burst. Well, with the federal government, the problem is not today's deficits, although they're bad, $1.42 trillion. It's not today's debt, although it's high, $12.3 trillion. It's the off-balance sheet obligations, $40 to $50 trillion, that are growing rapidly by doing nothing under our status quo do-nothing path. Thirdly, too much debt, not enough focus on cash flow, and over-reliance on credit ratings. Well, today, the United States is accumulating debt at rapid rates. We're already negative cash flow for Medicare, for Social Security, both disability and retirement income. FDIC has had to get 2 years of advance payments in order to be able to deal with its obligations. The highway trust funds are running out of money. The airport trust funds are running out of money. Cash is key. Just ask Bear Stearns. They were worth a lot of money on paper, but they couldn't meet their obligations when they were due, and they're now out of business. And fourth, and not least, the issue of a failure of responsible parties, in the case of the mortgage-related subprime, both corporate and government, to take preemptive actions to deal with a large known and growing problem until it hit crisis proportions, and then people reacted precipitously without adequate due diligence. The federal government has those same problems. There are two big differences. The size and scale of the federal government's problems, much bigger, and therefore the risk, not only to ourselves, but to the global economy, is much bigger. And secondly, nobody's going to bail out America. We have to solve our own problems. And we better start soon, and we better start before our foreign lenders lose confidence in our ability to do so. And let me touch on that. Today, 50% of debt held by the public is held by foreign lenders, China, Japan, Saudi Arabia, other OPEC nations. We are fortunate that they are willing to lend us the money at low rates because we have a low savings rate. Americans are generally very good at spending, not very good at saving. And the fact is that we have been fortunate that they have been willing to lend us the money at low rates, but we have become unduly reliant on their willingness and ability to do so. And if they lose confidence in our ability to put our own financial house in order, they could end up significantly reducing their willingness to do so and charging a lot higher interest rates in order to be able to finance our debt. The simple truth is that even if we don't have an increase in interest rates, the path that we're on means that the single largest expense for the federal budget in 12 years will be interest on the federal debt. More than defense, more than Social Security, more than Medicare, more than Medicaid, the single largest expense without an increase in interest rates, and I can assure you, interest rates are going up when the economy turns around and we get past the immediate crises. And what do we get for interest? Nothing, nada, or as we say in the South, shinola. It's paying for past excess sins. The other thing that we're seeing going on in our finances is that if you look at the express and enumerated responsibilities for the federal government as envisioned by the founders, at the beginning of the Republic, 100% of federal government spending was for the express and enumerated responsibilities envisioned by the founders. Today, less than 40% of the federal government's expenditures
or for those expressed enumerated responsibilities. Things like national defense, foreign policy, federal judicial system, interstate transportation systems, Congress of the United States, Executive Office of the President, and that is being squeezed. And in fact, if you look at what's going on, for our young people, who I'm most concerned about, my children, but more so my grandchildren, we're doing three things to them on our current path. We are mortgaging their future at record rates. We are reducing relative investments in their future at a time where they will face increasing competition in a global economy. That's called in the South a triple whammy. That's not good. And we need to start doing something about it. So the fact is that we're going to have to start making tough choices. And it's important to recognize that from a financial standpoint, there's two dimensions. There's the short term and the structural. President Obama was dealt a bad hand. When he came into office, he inherited a $1.2 trillion deficit for fiscal 2009. It turned out being $1.42 trillion after actions that were taken during the year. The current deficit is due largely because of the recession, two undeclared wars, increases in spending in recent years, as well as some tax cuts that didn't pay for themselves. But the threat to our future is not the current deficits, some of which are understandable and, in fact, even necessary to stimulate the economy and to try to deal with unemployment. The threat to our future are the large, known, and growing deficits that existed before the recession, that existed when we didn't have an unemployment problem, that now are bigger and they are closer to hitting our shores, and we are not prepared, in particular, health care cost. If there's one thing that could bankrupt America, it's health care cost. Believe it or not, we are the only country in the industrialized world that doesn't have a budget for what the federal government will spend for health care. We write a blank check. No other country is dumb enough to do that because it will bankrupt the country. We're going to have a budget. We're going to have to change our payment systems from fee-for-service to paying more for outcomes. We're going to have to look at the hundreds of billions of tax preferences accorded to employer-provided and paid health insurance arrangements. We're going to have to look and better target subsidies for middle and upper-income individuals, for Medicare's voluntary payment programs. We're going to have to do these things and more in order to make sure that we have a sound safety net, we move to some level of universal coverage for basic and essential, but something that's affordable and sustainable over time, because we already have $38 trillion in unfunded promises for Medicare. $38 trillion. We can't just add a wing onto a healthcare house that is structurally unsound and headed for foreclosure. That's not adequate. That's not progress. We have to focus on some of the fundamental drivers of cost. For Social Security, we need to make it solvent, sustainable, secure, and more savings-oriented. It's going to be there for young people. We should not be talking about making changes to people who are retired or who are close to retirement, with the possible exception of refining the basis of calculating cost of living, where there's some controversy with that. But for younger people, and for those that are better off, we need to make some changes to make sure the program will be there indefinitely. And that means things like strengthening the benefit for people near the poverty level, because too many people rely solely on Social Security. It means providing somewhat less benefit for middle and upper income. And it also means encouraging people to work longer, because we're now in a knowledge-based economy where it's brain power rather than brawn power that drives the economy, while also recognizing that people that are in heavy labor jobs may not be able to work as long, and so they ought to be able to get out at an earlier age through the disability aspect. But we also need to not only have a solvent, sustainable, and secure base defined benefit program for Social Security, which is the foundation of retirement income security, we need to increase our savings rate. So we need to have an add-on supplemental savings account that's payroll deduction, that goes into a real trust fund with real investments, with real fiduciary responsibility and liabilities, that would provide for a supplemental retirement benefit and a pre-retirement death benefit, and that would help to get our savings rate up so that we can reduce our dependence on foreign lenders. So yes, Social Security can be solved, and frankly, it's pretty darn easy. We ought to get some points on the board to gain some credibility and some confidence so we can go on to some tougher decisions like the health care decisions that I touched on and also the tax decisions that we're going to need to deal with. Yes, taxes are going up. And they're going up on a lot more people than those making $250,000 or more. Why? A new, very simple four-letter word. Math. The math does not come close to working. The simple fact of the matter is that we're going to have to reform our tax system to make it more streamlined and more simplified, to broaden the base, to keep rates as low as possible. We're also going to need to pursue some type of a consumption-based tax, probably a value-added tax, probably dedicated towards health care. But I would respectfully suggest, before you send another dime of taxes to Washington, D.C., that Washington must reimpose tough statutory budget controls that expired in 2002 that would take effect after we turn the corner on the economy and get unemployment down somewhat. And Washington must make round one of social insurance reform as well as health care cost controls, because otherwise, if those things don't happen, the risk of that money being wasted, again, is very great. We need to also go back to the future, to what President Bush 41 and President William Jefferson Clinton did. They broke campaign promises on taxes, they imposed tough statutory budget controls, and they didn't expand entitlement programs. All three did the right thing for America, even though they paid a political price. And President Obama is going to need to do the same thing. The fact of the matter is that, you know, we are going to have to make tough choices, and President Obama is going to have to end up probably taking actions dealing with all three of those things. He promised to do some things or not to do some things on taxes that he shouldn't have, and he's going to have to reconsider those promises. He needs to reimpose tough statutory budget controls, as the two presidents I mentioned did, but that would take effect after we turn the corner on the economy and after we end up reducing unemployment. And yes, he's going to have to also restrain himself from expanding entitlement programs when we've already made tens of trillions of dollars in promises that we don't know how we're going to keep. What are some other things we need to do? As I said, taxes are going to go up. Ladies and gentlemen, there's two kinds of taxes. There's current taxes and there's deferred taxes. And to the extent that you have large, known, and growing structural deficits, they represent deferred taxes that will have to be paid by future taxpayers with interest. That's our kids and our grandkids. What is going on today is massive taxation without representation. It's easy to spend somebody else's money. It's even easier to spend somebody else's money when they're too young to vote or they're not born yet. Don't tax you, don't tax me, tax the person behind the tree. The new saying is, don't tax you, don't tax me, tax the baby on your knee. That's the new saying, all right? Now, don't get me wrong. Most of our imbalance is going to have to be restructured through constraining health care cost growth, the restructuring the social insurance program so that we have them solvent, sustainable, and secure, a sound and safety net that we actually can make sure that we can sustain. But we're going to have more revenues because the numbers just don't work. Don't pay attention to those people who tell you we can grow our way out. Why? Math. It takes double-digit real GDP growth every year for decades to grow your way out of this problem. We're in an over $60 trillion hole that grows by several trillion a year by doing nothing. Don't pay attention to people that tell you that we can inflate our way out of the problem. Because the problem is not today's debt. The problem are those off-balance sheet, $40 to $50 trillion in obligations that grow not only faster than inflation, they grow faster than the economy when the economy is growing. So the bottom line is that we're going to have to make tough choices on social insurance, on budget controls, on taxes. And we need to start by putting together a process in 2010 that will engage the American people with the facts and the truth, the tough choices, the prudence of acting sooner rather than later, and the potential adverse consequences to our country and our families if we don't. At the same time, we're going to need to take steps to try to help ensure that the economy recovers in a sustainable fashion and to get unemployment down. And so that means that Washington's probably going to take some steps that will increase the deficit in the short term, which is troubling, but possibly necessary and acceptable if it's done the right way and structured properly, and if we learn the lessons from the mistakes of the first stimulus program and other bailout efforts. But it's absolutely imperative that Washington put some type of a process in place, fiscal future commission, call it whatever you want, preferably statutory, presidential if not statutory, that will engage the American people with the facts and the truth and the tough choices, where everything is on the table, and will make recommendations so that the Congress is forced to vote on some things that otherwise it might wait until we have a crisis. And we can't afford to wait for the type of crisis we might get, because it would be a global depression. We must not allow that to happen. It doesn't have to be that way. I don't want it to be that way. And if we end up following some of the recommendations that are in the book, it won't be that way. Yes, we can take steps to help create a better future. But to do it, we're going to have to make tough choices sooner rather than later. The book lays out policy options, operational options, and I'll end on this so we have plenty of time for Q&A. We have a dysfunctional democracy. We have a republic that is not representative of the public. We have something that the founding fathers never intended. When this country was founded, we wanted people to come out of the real world who had real experience and to do short to medium term service, public service, and then go back to the real world. And today what we have all too frequently is people who don't come out of the real world. They go to the la-la land of the East, Washington. They want to be career politicians, and they never go back to the real world. That is a fundamental disconnect between the governed and the governing that is an increasing problem. We need to change how we redistrict so that we have more representative and more competitive districts, so that we don't entrench incumbents, so that we don't protect political parties, and so that we don't create an ideological divide where only 60 seats out of 435 in the House are really competitive, and where the Republicans are more conservative in the country because their elections are decided in the primary, and the Democrats are more liberal in the country because their elections are decided in the primary. You drive people to the polls. You don't have a sensible center. You can't make deals. That creates stalemate. Stalemate's okay if things are going well, but if things aren't going well and they're getting worse with the passage of time, it's a disaster. Secondly, we need campaign finance reform, even more evident as a result of the Supreme Court decision last week. And thirdly, in my opinion, there are pros and cons. We need term limits, 12 to 18 year term limits. If you want to be a career politician, fine, just not in the same job, because that does not facilitate transformational change. That does not facilitate accountability. That does not facilitate the kinds of things that we need in order to help create a better future. And we're going to need some constitutional amendments. A couple of things that I just mentioned are going to require constitutional amendments. We also need a constitutional amendment to put a limit on the credit card. We don't have a constitutional limit on debt to GDP. Other countries do. We need one. We actually have a credit card limit now. The Chinese just haven't told us what it is. I would prefer to know what it is, and I would prefer to have steps, statutory and otherwise, to keep it below that. But frankly, just as we need to have new statutory budget controls, we need some constitutional limits. In summary, this is a great country. Our greatest years can be ahead of us if we wake up, if we start making tough choices, if we engage in some shared sacrifice today to help create a better tomorrow. It's going to require fundamental transformational policy, operational, and political changes in installments over time, but we need to start in 2010. And to be successful, the first three words in the Constitution, which are the most powerful words, have to come alive. We the people. And they are coming alive. Massachusetts was not a victory for Republicans. Massachusetts was a victory for independents and we the people. And I have been in 46 states. There is a tide. This tide must be a positive tide, a constructive tide, not a destructive tide. And it's important that we all be part of the solution so that we can discharge our stewardship responsibilities to our children and grandchildren. Thank you very much.
Our thanks to David Walker, former U.S. Comptroller General and author of the new book, Come Back America, Turning the Country Around and Restoring Fiscal Responsibility. I'm Don McGrath, member of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors, and I will be moderating today's audience question period. And Mr. Walker, we have a very large number of questions.
Your cup runneth over, Don.
They are not going to have a problem filling the time. They're concentrated in several areas, and I think one that's particularly interesting is a focus around the recent steps that were taken to bail out financial institutions and the auto industry. And so I think the specific question is, what's your overall view of the expenditures that were made in that area, and what do you think that's done to our shorter long-term problems?
Well, first, I think that some of the financial assistance efforts were necessary in order to prevent a meltdown of the system. But I do believe that we didn't do three things that need to exist, whether it's for bailouts, stimulus programs, or whatever. You have to have clearly defined outcome-based objectives. You need to have appropriate criteria established up front as to who should get the money and who shouldn't. And number three, you need to have appropriate conditions established up front as to what you can and can't do with the money. We were 0 for 3. That's called a strikeout. So we wasted a lot of money. And now there's going to be some discussion about doing some more things, and we need to learn those lessons. As far as General Motors, the federal government should never own a majority stake of a manufacturing enterprise. Should never own a majority stake of anything. The federal government could have and should have taken steps to provide assistance with regard to warranties and post-petition financing. It should never be in a position to own a majority stake in an enterprise. Those companies were headed for bankruptcy. Everybody knew it. The reason that you have Chapter 11 is to reorganize. It set a very dangerous precedent, and hopefully one that we won't follow on a repeated basis.
You mentioned in your speech the role of the Federal Reserve. There are lots of current issues, including the reappointment of the chairman of the Federal Reserve. Could you comment on your view of their role in solving the problem and what would be the right approach?
Well, first, my book talks primarily about fiscal policy, which is tax and spending, but monetary policy, which is, you know, the money supply, is obviously the responsibility of the Federal Reserve. The way I would look for the Federal Reserve is they have three primary responsibilities: monetary policy, bank regulation and oversight, and a new line of business called the bailout business. In my view, they need flexibility, and you don't want politicians to get involved in monetary policy because they're not doing a very good job on fiscal policy. But on the other hand, the Federal Reserve did not do a very good job with regard to bank regulation and oversight. And they have engaged in a number of unprecedented activities in the bailout business, so they need more transparency, more accountability, more oversight, and, you know, GAO, you know, audit authority in the latter two areas. As far as Chairman Bernanke, I think he's probably going to get re-upped as chairman. There are pluses and minuses to Chairman Bernanke, but I think the fact of the matter is that he stepped into the breach at a time when, frankly, the executive branch and the Congress wouldn't. And so those are a few of my thoughts.
The current cost structure of our medical system is causing problems everywhere, most importantly in the entitlement systems. Is it true that a single-payer system would be cheaper?
Not necessarily. You know, I do think that we need, we do need a system that provides for some level of universal coverage for preventative wellness and catastrophic. And I think we need to have central financing for that. I mean, government financing for that, if you will. But as far as the system as a whole, you have to keep in mind the following. Medicare is single payer. Medicare has lower administrative expenses than private sector insurance systems. It has much, much, much higher fraud, waste, abuse, and mismanagement. Much, much, much higher. The fundamental problems that we have is our system is a fee-for-service system, which means that you get paid more the more that you do, which also means that because of our malpractice system, people do more in order to minimize the possibility of getting sued. You don't get paid for outcomes, you get paid for activities. We've got to change that. That is the single most important change that we need to make to move to more evidence-based practice based on outcomes, such that we end up not only paying more for results, but that if physicians practice in accordance with these evidence-based standards, they have a safe harbor against malpractice litigation. Because the biggest cost of malpractice is not the jury awards, although I argue in the book that we need an alternative judicial system, an alternative court like we have for bankruptcies for healthcare. It's the defensive medicine cost that because of the things that are done in order to avoid litigation.
I'll remind our radio audience, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is David Walker, former U.S. Comptroller General, who is discussing America's economic crisis and how to reduce the country's budget deficit. Our next question is, again, focused on something you talked a bit on in your speech about. Would you discuss the pluses and minuses of some form of devaluation as a way to reduce the debt that we're carrying forward?
Well, I talked about the fact that you can't inflate your way out of the problem. And if there's some type of a devaluation, that could help in the short term, and it might be able to help with regard to exports. But ultimately, we're not going to be able to avoid making tough choices because we have a structural imbalance that's not going to go away. And the real challenge to our future is not where we are now, it's where we're headed. Envision an iceberg. We see what's above the water, but what threatens the ship of state is what's below the water and off the balance sheet. And those things aren't going to be solved with a devaluation or with inflation. They require tough choices.
David, you've talked about constitutional amendments. How do you feel about the right to filibuster, which is something that's particularly timely at the moment?
Well, you know, I think, you know, you have to keep in mind that when the framers developed the Constitution, they knew that the House would be very responsive to the needs of the people, and they wanted a separate body that would be a, what they call a cooling mechanism that wouldn't be subject to the emotions of the public at any given point in time. And one of the basic aspects of that is debate. Now, believe it or not, right now it's 60 votes. It used to be two-thirds. So it's actually less than it was before. And sometimes it can be frustrating. But the whole idea is that the Senate is supposed to be a cooling mechanism. What's frustrating to me is that all too frequently these things are party line activities. I would be less frustrated by it if they weren't party line filibusters. And in fact, I think that goes back to some of the political reforms that we need.
Right. What is the significance of the sort of generally accepted movement across the country in business, but also now in government toward fair value accounting?
Well, you're talking about the private sector or with regard to the public sector? Okay. Well, first you have to understand that the government actually does have financial statements and actually does have audited financial statements, meaning the federal government. What's interesting is we didn't have them until the 1990s. So we were kind of a lag indicator. It kind of took a while to get there. And when you look at it, you have to understand the difference between what the assets are considered to be and the liabilities. On the assets, some of our most valuable assets aren't shown as an asset on the balance sheet. The federal government owns about 20% of the country, all right? But it doesn't have any intention of selling that land. The federal government owns some priceless national monuments, but it has no intention of selling that. The federal government owns a number of weapon systems, but we're not planning to sell that as well. And so, you know, when you look at it, there are, however, things that we ought to be capturing better, I believe, which is the value of mineral rights, timber rights, and other type of rights, which quite frankly, all too frequently, the taxpayers don't get treated fairly because there are sweetheart deals that are done over some of those public, the public mineral rights and asset rights. It's not going to have a major impact, I think, on the federal. It's more of an issue on the private sector than it is the federal government's financial statements. By the way, the federal government does book a liability for the entire unfunded obligation of civilian and military pensions and retiree health care, which is trillions of dollars. But it books a liability, so it's there. You see it.
Lots of questions about the significance of off-balance sheet debt, which you're commenting on there. Since it's off-balance sheet and since it's not current, give us a relative worry compared to current obligations.
Well, first, as I said, the federal government's been engaging in creative accounting and self-dealing practices for years, and let me use Social Security as a perfect example of that. Social Security, we all send money in for payroll taxes. The government spends every dime of it, every dime. To the extent that more payroll taxes come in than are necessary to pay current benefits, it spends it on other things, whether it's defense or infrastructure or paying salaries or whatever it might be. And it gives back a bond that's non-readily marketable, can't be sold. It bears interest at the current rate of interest that other people bid on for the public debt. It's guaranteed by the full faith and credit of the United States government, both as to principal and interest, and I think it'll be honored. But the government doesn't consider it a liability. They don't consider it a liability, even though in the Social Security financial statements they hold it out as an asset. I think that's duplicitous. I think that's wrong. It's several trillion dollars. And the result of that is that our deficits are actually worse than advertised, and the amount of debt that we have as a percentage of the economy is actually worse than advertised because they don't want to count that in those numbers. The real problem with Social Security is not that. It's the fact that we've got multiple times those bonds that are unfunded promises. But let me come back. Social Security is not the major challenge. It's Medicare. Medicare is $38 trillion in the hole. And that number grows by about $2 trillion a year by doing nothing.
High earners currently don't pay Social Security taxes above a certain level, although they do pay Medicare taxes. Mm-hmm. Can you comment on the topic and what should be done?
Yeah, I think right now, wage earners and self-employment earnings, pay 1.45% unlimited for Medicare, and the employers pay 1.45%. So that's 2.9%. On Social Security, you pay 6.2% each side up to about $106,700, I believe it is right now. If you ended up eliminating that, you would be talking about a 12.4% increase, especially for the self-employed. Mm-hmm. And that's a big tax increase, 12.4%, all right? This is supposed to be a social insurance program. My view is that you could consider, as I put out in the book, raising the taxable wage base cap mm-hmm. from maybe $106,700 to about $150,000. But eliminating it, I think, would go way too far because the program already provides higher levels of benefit for the less well-off and less benefits for the better-off. And so I think that would just be too much. It would undercut public support, I think, for a very important social insurance program that we need to maintain public support for. If we're going to need more revenues, let's do it through a consumption-based tax, or let's do it through a broader reform of our income tax system. You know, if we're going to use the money for general revenue purposes, let's have a revenue source that's supposed to be used for general purposes, not a Social Security tax that's supposed to be earmarked towards a social insurance program.
If you had the ability to control healthcare reform, what would you do?
Okay. First, I believe that we have to establish a budget on what the federal government will spend on healthcare. Every other industrialized nation has done that, including countries that have socialized medicine cradle to grave, which I don't advocate, but even they recognize you have to do that. Secondly, I think we have to move away from the fee-for-service payment system by establishing national evidence-based practice standards that would be decided based upon what works, what doesn't work, which would be applied by physicians, not by government workers. So physicians would use these national evidence-based standards to make decisions on what to do and what not to do based upon whether or not it improved or extended life and enhanced quality of life in a meaningful way, given the budget that's been allocated. I think we need to tax the value of employer-provided and paid health care benefits in excess of a stated level of coverage, a basic and essential level of coverage. If you get more than that, you should be taxed on it, whether you're in a union or you're not in a union. It's compensation. It should be irrelevant whether you're in a union or not. I think we need to change premiums for the voluntary Medicare programs so that everybody has an opportunity to sign up, but we have more of a means-based premium system so that we provide significant subsidies to the near poor, less subsidies to moderate income, and no subsidies to wealthy people. It's a voluntary program. Believe it or not, under Medicare Part B, which is outpatient and physicians, and then Medicare Part D, which is prescription drugs, billionaires can get subsidies for those programs, for voluntary sign-up for those programs. And who's going to end up paying for those subsidies? Our kids and our grandkids with interest. Now, this is more than a billionaire issue, all right? This is an issue for people. You can get subsidies for dual-income families who are making $450,000 a year in retirement. Why should the taxpayers subsidize people that are making $450,000 a year in retirement? I don't think so. Those are a few examples.
Thank you.
By the way, I'm not a billionaire, and I don't make $450,000 a year either.
If you had to pick one country or two as an example of folks who have done a better job of this than we have, give us an example.
Canada, Australia, or two. In fact, I talk about the fact that my plan A is to help save the Republic, not to save mankind or the world. That's overreaching. Just save the Republic. But I do have a plan B. Vancouver, British Columbia, because New Zealand is too far.
David, looking around our audience tonight, we see that most of the folks here are, let's say, of an age. So they're
seasoned, experienced.
Seasoned, experienced.
That's right.
Folks with us this evening. And there are a number of questions about how we go about exciting younger folks who arguably will be paying the cost of this issue. And there were several comments about a documentary, which I think you were engaged in, which is called IOU USA. So if you could comment on that a bit.
Well, our foundation funded the distribution of a critically acclaimed documentary called IOU USA, which came out about a year and a half ago. And we are currently funding a follow-on to that, which is not a full-length documentary. It's going to be about 30 minutes in length, and it's tentatively titled IOU USA Solutions. And it will come out within the next couple of months. It will update the numbers, but rather than just talking about the problem, which everybody knows, it will end up talking about illustrative solutions for Social Security, healthcare, taxes, budget controls, because my view is that we need to start focusing on the solutions and how we can make those solutions a reality. We will give it away for free. We will post it to the internet. We'll make it available for you know, for schools and other interested groups. And we have an agreement in principle for CNN to be able to do a special on it when it comes out, just as they did a special on the original documentary back in the past.
You talked a bit about debt limits, and we've had a number of questions from our audience about debt limits. I think the most creative is the person who wants to know what happened to the lockbox.
The lockbox got picked a long time ago. In fact, you know, believe it or not, you know, the trust funds, as I've talked to you about, you know, they are represented by computer runs in a locked file cabinet in West Virginia. At least it's locked, but it's computer runs.
We've had also a number of questions about the Fed's or the federal government's engagement with Fannie Freddie and the mortgage business and the subsidization of the mortgage business.
Interesting, yes.
Obviously, that is a continuing obligation, and could you comment on that?
Well, here's an example of new creative accounting and self-dealing. The federal government owns a supermajority of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, the two housing entities, and yet it's not consolidating those into the financial statements of the U.S. government, even though they're experiencing significant losses. Here's another example of how your foreign lenders can have an influence over you. Today, the taxpayers of the United States now guarantee $5 trillion in Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac debt, who are not guaranteed by the full faith and credit of the United States government. Why? Because the Japanese and the Chinese demanded it. Because they demanded it. You know, we have to keep in mind that you must pay attention to your foreign bankers. And we're no exception to that rule. You know, great powers do not stay great if they're not economically strong. Great powers are not debtor nations, they're creditor nations. And we are the world's largest debtor nation.
Speaking of the revenue side of the equation, how can we stimulate our economy and get our economy to the point that it produces enough revenue at any level of taxation where it begins to pay for these costs that go forward?
Well, there are clearly things that we need to do in order to try to help economic growth and in order to try to help our economic posture. I mean, for example, take our education system. You know, in the United States, we have to compete on skills, knowledge, productivity, value added, and yet we're not top 25 in the world in our K-12 education system. So we're going to need to make some transformational changes in that regard. We're going to need to improve the competitiveness of our corporate tax structure. We're going to need to invest more in basic research than we do right now. We're going to need to invest more in critical infrastructure that can help improve our competitive posture and enhance economic growth. We're also going to need to focus more on fair trade agreements rather than just free trade agreements. Both are important, if you will, in order to make sure that there's a more level playing field with regard to global trade activities. Those are a few examples, Don.
You talk in your book, and you talk this evening about the differences between short-term deficiencies or short-term structural problems or short-term deficits and long-term structural problems. Could you comment on whether you believe our competitive position is the former short-term or the latter long-term?
I think our competitive posture is eroding because if you look at what are we doing with regard to investments in basic research, investments in critical infrastructure, what's our performance with regard to education, what's our status with regard to public finance? These are all eroding. And that's why I think that we need to wake up and assess where we are and make some more meaningful transformational changes. You know, there are two systems in this country where we spend double per person than any other country on Earth, and we have below average results. Let me restate that. We spend double per person and we have below average results, and they are healthcare and K-12 education. So the issue is not a matter of whether or not we're spending enough money. It's the fact that the system is badly broken, and we need to make transformational changes to get better value for money. That's what we have to do. And it's not going to be easy, and it's not going to happen overnight, but we need to get started soon.
2 days from now, we have President Obama's State of the Union address on Wednesday evening. If you had the pen and a chance to put a few key points into his presentation, what would you do?
Well, from the economic standpoint, I would say that President Obama needs to focus on two things. He needs to focus on taking additional steps to help ensure that we achieve a sustainable economic recovery and to get unemployment down. That means that he may well propose some additional government actions designed to do that that could end up exacerbating our deficit problem in the short term. But if he does that, he needs to learn the lessons from the mistakes that were made by the previous administration and his administration in connection with stimulus, bailout, and other efforts where we didn't have, you know, proper objectives, criteria, and conditions established up front. The stimulus program, for example, $787 billion, only 30% of it was true stimulus. So it was big enough, it just wasn't designed properly, if you will. Secondly, he must put a process in place, either in conjunction with the Congress or acting through executive order, that will state the facts and speak the truth to the American people about the tough choices we need to make to put our own federal financial house in order through a fiscal future commission. He must make that a reality early in 2010 so that we can end up making tough choices in 2011. So short term and structural, we need to walk and chew gum at the same time.
There are a number of questions which I guess would be along the side of equal time, asking what you would have now advised the Bush administration to do.
First, there are two Bush administrations, and they're very, very different. There's Bush 43, and there's Bush 41. In the book, I have a number of positive things to say about Bush 43, and the facts speak for them. 41, I apologize. Ooh, God, mercy. Let me restate that. I have a number of positive things to say about Bush 41, George Herbert Walker Bush, and the facts speak for themselves with regard to George Walker Bush 43. Arguably, he was the most fiscally irresponsible president in the history of the Republic. However, his record could be beaten, which is not a positive thing, unless we start making tough choices soon. I think President Obama's got him in it. I think he's got it in him. And I think 2010 is his year to show us whether he's going to do it or not. And I hope he does.
Do you think the leadership for the solution to our problems is more likely to come from the executive branch or the legislative branch?
You cannot run a country by committee. The Congress is a committee. Nobody's in charge of the committee. People are in charge of factions known as political parties, but they're not in charge of the body as a whole. Only the President of the United States has the bully pulpit to be able to take the lead on this. Ultimately, Congress has a critically important role to play, but the President must take the lead, and the type of process that we employ has to be much more open, much more citizen education engagement, much more transparent than Washington typically does, because the normal way that Washington does business hasn't worked, won't work, and that's what people are rebelling to, quite frankly.
What influence and what role should the GAO have on government economic policy?
Well, the GAO is involved in promoting transparency, helping to improve performance and assure accountability of executive branch activities for the legislative branch, and it does a very good job. I mean, when I left GAO, we were generating over $100 in return for every dollar the taxpayers invested in GAO, which was up dramatically from when I came in. And so, you know, they do a good job. They're one of the few areas in government, and there are others. Social Security, I think, does a good job, where they actually generate value for money for what the taxpayers give. But it's not their job to make policy. And they shouldn't be involved in the policy business because that's going to undercut their effectiveness in being able to be in the transparency, performance, and accountability business.
One of our listeners has the view that many Americans have been deliberately brainwashed by some groups that all taxes are bad. Can they be, or should they be, is another question, but can they be re-educated, and if so, how?
Well, the government has to have revenues to be able to pay its bills and deliver on the promises that it intends to keep. There are different ways of generating revenues. We used to be able to finance the government with tariffs. You know, we didn't even have an income tax in this country, a continuing income tax, until 1913, all right? And so the fact of the matter is that you need to generate revenues to finance the operations of the government. And taxes are one of the ways that you do that. Preferably, you can do it through growing the economy to minimize tax burdens, but I've already told you that there's no way we can grow our way out of this problem. You want to make sure that you've got a tax system that's competitive, that's equitable, that's fair, that it's administratable, but in the end, you got to have a system that will, with economic growth, generate enough money to pay your bills and deliver on the promises you intend to keep. The key is we've been spending a lot more money than we're taking in for a long time. So we're going to have more revenues, but there's going to have to be much more achieved on the spending side, which is a bigger part of the problem, than on the revenue side. Yes, we need more revenues. Yes, taxes are going up. But spending is going to have to be constrained and reprioritized to a greater extent than revenues are going to be enhanced.
Do you believe that it's going to take a further economic crisis to make a material change in this problem set?
I sure hope not, because the type of economic crisis that we would get is one that we would never want to see. You know, if we have what I call a super subprime crisis, which would be a loss of confidence by foreign lenders in the ability to put its own, the federal government's ability to put its own finances in order, that would be a dramatic decline in the dollar, a dramatic increase in interest rates that would have a very adverse effect on America and Americans and the global economy. We don't want that.
David, we've come to the point in our program where we have time for just really one more question, and we've covered a broad sort of raft of questions, but I think this one sort of sums up what everybody understands about attitude change. And what do you see as the most important shift in individual and national thinking that needs to take place for us to get a handle on our fiscal problems?
We can't just live for today. We need to take steps to help create a better tomorrow. We have three maladies in America today: short-sightedness, tunnel vision, and self-interest. We need to combat those maladies on an individual level, in the private sector, and in government. It isn't going to happen overnight, but we need to start now. Thank you.
Our thanks to David Walker, former U.S. Comptroller General and author of the new book, Come Back America, Turning the Country Around and Restoring Fiscal Responsibility. We also thank our audiences here and on the radio, television, and the Internet. Today's program has been underwritten by the Corrett Foundation as part of the Principles of Free Society series. I'm Don McGrath, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're in the know, is adjourned.